this part is, will be that next step.
I just went to a website with a print on the table, and I think, I think it'd be best to have, we'll have the nav bar fixed. This is kind of like a rough fix, we just made this page. So, after this gets set up, we'll have the nav bar on the top, you can go back to the other page, you'll see Rex and click on it. You, obviously, you can go back. The new, contact button will just be, we can just put it on the bottom right there, in the middle or whatever, and then, that'll take you to the, forms you had before where it had the actual, like, salutation, all the things that you were looking for that record. It'll just take you to that page.
Yep.
And then that will allow you to do the new record, or whatever it is.
Yep.
The only thing that we haven't done, with this, is we haven't set up anything where it would take anywhere, because otherwise it'd just be like a dummy link. Because we can have like a open contact or whatever it is in here, so that if you click on it, it'll take you to that actual record. That's in read only, and you can update it. Because obviously, there's a record in here, it's completely up to them. So, it'll have that information. So that's what people really need to do is add, let's say, a create new contact button, like, piece of size, or whatever.
No.
And then have the nav bar.
Is that just from a URL?
Probably down a little farther.
I went to this website. I just looked up. Give me a
Right, but what I'm saying, why don't you give me that?
The queries.
Why don't you give me the website you went to, and then you can show it to us.
Will be the, probably like a search will drop down, kind of like the main ones you said for each month. Every year or whatever, and we'll have those in one. On the issue that's in there, like a search capability for the ones, it's a lot more like 49
server underscore site
scroll. So,
so like
if you can so, and then just have a print. I mean, obviously, you can print like straight from the screen.
Okay. Why don't you?
Yeah.
Alright, start with the he wants, Ethan wanted to show you something.
I'm here. Show me.
You show right up there.
I have to tell you your PKs and your, what is it? FKs, right? You know, you do realize that I actually had to look that up in a Google search.
Can you do your reports in Excel? Mm-hmm. Okay. So, I was messing around with this. And I went to data. And I saw a thing where you can go from web. Since this is going to be like a web-based application.
Okay.
I just went to a random website that just has something like this, you know, in it. And just right-click on the page and save as. It'll save it as that. I'm going to save it to the desktop here.
Okay.
Make it simple. Alright, and it's right here. So then I opened it up, and it gives you, instead of that website, right, instead of that up here, okay, it's giving you the file path.
Right there. I see.
Yeah, so you're going to copy that, basically. Go into Excel, into like one of these blank ones, or whatever. Go to From Web. Yeah, but it's a different... Yeah, that's screwed up, but
just doesn't allow me to make another one.
Yeah.
So if you just go through that and then we'll paste that in the address.
Should be, yeah.
What you just said, and then you can just sit there and go to the bottom.
No, it's a different, well,
yeah,
I have a different window for some reason, like on mine, so I need to be able, like I need to try and find that, because I have it to where I just exclusively got that table that was on that website, and nothing more, so I'm going to have to mess around with this and be able to find like, I have a new version of it, but there was a point where like this window did come up, and let me go into options here. Other sources maybe.
Well, from SQL Server, so that you basically.
Pretty much, yeah.
Which is all I'm looking for anyway, because I mean, we're going to be exporting and using the data for one of two things, right?
Hold on. Can you scroll down in that window? Go to your table. Mm-hmm. Or like hold on, go up to your thing and then paste it in. I gotta ask me how to do it. So copy
yeah.
It, paste it in. And then scroll down to your table and there should be a little yellow arrow next to it.
Right.
And then try clicking that. Not that one, keep going.
There's not. There should be.
Oh, go to your. Hold on. Click on that thing that says on the top. Click just the options. No, like the old yellow bar right there.
Yeah.
And we'll hit allow. Okay. Now look and see if you can find that. So that typically does not just block some stuff. That's the idea of it. I don't know, but you should be able to just select the thing next to the table you want.
Unless I didn't put the right URLs on them, just wrote down what you.
No, you just copied this.
Yeah.
Does it see how there's like a little arrow right now where it says data table? Well, what that's doing is it's taking the table itself. I don't think it's actually grabbing the, or recognizing the other thing at the table. I don't know why, but that's the idea, but it's just not done enough for some reason. So.
Yeah,
that's
what
mine.
Why don't you step over by her and just show her what you just did?
Yeah.
On your, no, take it from the top, I mean, and just show her everything you just did.
Right.
I don't know why we won't do it on here, but it definitely doesn't make sense. So. It might be a good people. Yeah.
Let's
see what
we do.
No, I don't think it's going to be much. You have to do like the academy card.
No.
So that's our first two.
Yeah, just because we need to get on that, we'll be fine to get that. As long as we have the, actually knowing this crime, actually, or something, then all we have to do is, instead of having the double records we have, if we just have this sort of data for the rest, if we didn't have any other good records, then yes. So then once we put in like a system,
we can put up data, but that's probably not going to help you.
Correct.
You want the data.
Right. So, I don't know. I mean, in this case, it's not going to help you. Whereas, no one.
Huh.
Someone more things. You can make them clutter other things you just not you don't have to do.
Well, it's one thing that you need to know what fields are required and usually have one which ones are not required.
You need to ask that in your checklist.
Yeah, the ones that aren't required
that's
that you don't have, somebody's gotta put them in now. Because she's not going to be able to see how this all fits together until everything is basically, you know.
Set up for
yeah. And it's not right now, so.
But you can't do it.
It looks like much better than it can be.
I mean, I think so.
That's not what it's.
Yeah.
I don't mind doing it, but, I mean, it needs to be figured out, you know.
But these, like I said, this is for people.
Well, the other thing that I would have to do is if you make it required, you have nothing in there, if you've already got information in, okay? So you've already got these tables, and you've already put all that information in, then you go back and basically create a field, okay? Which is backwards, but I would say that's something to do. Then as soon as you go up and you try to query one of those, and look for a required field, and it doesn't have it, it breaks your thing. Now, I know that for sure, because I've done it.
Right, yeah.
But that's, well, I can say that for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's great. Because I know you can hard code in like the records and stuff. I just insert it. But how do you think that you'd be able to do it in this year?
Before the yard, I don't know why it's doing it, but it's Monday did it too. Like the first record on stuff I didn't do this. And then they did it. I don't know why.
Okay. When I sent you that email, I hope I didn't upset you or anything. But you know, the one where I talked about the fact that there was a lot of information missing and you keep going back and I wasn't at all supposing that you didn't. But I just mentioned Brady. And I realized somebody eventually I would think on your end is gonna have to do that because we don't have any clue as to what any of it is. But that said, if there would be any way that you could get them a representative sample, even 100, 200 records that were totally filled out. You see what I'm saying?
Can't. And I'm going to tell you why. Because we don't have
the information.
I mean, again, we could put dumb stuff in there, but the thing is where I have is that somebody has to somehow it's got to be annotated that it's dumb stuff.
Right.
And, you know what I'm saying? But the only this is my analogy. Maybe it stinks, but maybe you've seen those things before. Where somebody's trying to get a picture. They buy one of those pictures that has the different numbers on there, and you put this color in for that, etc. Okay. What we have is we're going to have a picture that's going to be half done.
Right.
And one thing that I think Ethan needs to know and his group needs to know is which fields that you have in there are required and which ones are, you know, the database terminology for it, which can be left null, which means unknown. For instance, you might just say, you know, that name, that nickname, we're just going to make it null for right now. We could maybe fill it in later if we get it, but we'll just leave it. But the problem is, that's what I'm saying, is that right now there are so many records. And if you say, for example, and this is what I was looking at when I was kind of going through all the information, I'm just making assumptions here, so maybe it's only one. But let's say you say, gotta have a phone number, chapter, okay? And I looked through that list of 2,466, I would say at least 10 to 20% of them didn't have phone numbers. I would say at least 20 to 30% didn't have email addresses. Sometimes you had one or the other, sometimes you had both. Usually you had one or you have the other, it's just about all of them, all right? But again, it's going to make it very hard for them to go through there and being able to show you all this stuff and without some representative data. I mean, even if there's something that you could fudge, that wouldn't, you know what I'm saying? That, okay, Jeff, I made this stuff up, but it is more representative. That way, they can start plugging all this in, and you can look at it. I think even with you, yeah, this looks real good, or et cetera, but until you actually see it in action, there's probably something that's missing that you won't know until you actually see the whole thing wired up.
Well, let me ask you a question. You have the table set up. You have this that I can start, that I can play 10 records. That if you send it to me in an email that I can send, that I can put 10, 20 records in.
I could generate the stuff that you need, or you could do it. I mean, I can show you how. But he's got, for all 13 tables, we should be able to do that. Within, it might not be till early next week, but yes.
So here's my thought. Here's my thought. Right. So here's my thought. It's not a very good one, but it's mine. If you give me, just as the same way that Brady had put in data into something that was able to be searchable, right? Let me put in the 15 employees that I have in FEDC, right? Let me start with a small data group where I have to go in and put that information in. Because here's what I think we're gonna find. We're not gonna have all the information for everything, right? EDC is gonna be brought up now as its own new company, right? So it's gonna have its own data in there. And so if I can do EDC 15 people, at least it gives me, I think, a better, then I think that we can kind of sit back and go, oh, here's what we saw.
What he has on there in the pictures and stuff that he's given me, that's literally referred to as a schema.
Right.
Okay? And what we will need to know is on every one of those tables, what fields are required.
Right. And I think that we can you.
Yes. Yes. But what she's saying, I think, is that what I want is for you to just basically give me the empty tables.
Just give me the empty tables.
And I'm going to start to populate them. So I will give you some representative data. And what I'm saying is that can be done. But she has to then say, other name. Do you want that to be required? And if she says, you know what, I like it, but I'm not going to probably get it for everybody, then you make it no.
Yeah,
but that's what your group needs is when you're setting that up, because literally it's a checkbox in SQL Server that says no. And if it's checked, that means that you will allow blank value. But by the same token, we don't want to make too many of those, because then when you search, you're not going to be able to get the information you want, because that stuff is, you know, is all going to be null.
Right.
Yeah, because I'm more worried about, because if you don't have the information, so let's say you don't have the phone number for every single record, you can't really make it a required field unless you have that, because if you put that in, and let's say you search for it, it'll search for that record. Well, once it finds that there's no phone number for this record, let's say, or like you type in Jamie or whatever, and Jamie doesn't have a phone number that's in, that will blow up the whole program.
Yeah, and the only way that you can get around that
is to do 00000.
Right.
Zero,
well,
zero, zero.
For have a dummy phone number, or have your phone number, for example, and have that be the default. Okay. And that way you would know if you search that table and you put in your phone number, you could quickly tell everybody who didn't have a phone number.
Well, and I worked in a database, and tell me how you did yours, because I'm not going to have a phone number. And that's the problem.
That's the issue.
This is the issue that I have. I cannot, for the life of me, I hope that I have a first name and a last name. And I will have a first name and a last name. If I don't have a first name and a last name in a company, then there's no reason why that person's going in, except for one problem. And I'm thinking of Diane Garrison, who doesn't work, right? So she's a, she is on the PFP. Look for Diane Garrison. Her last name is G.
Well, it'd be nice if I had a search feature here.
It does.
Is there? Yeah.
I don't.
There it is. I don't use Access.
Yeah, he doesn't have a company. So what you could do for that though is just put none or NA as like.
But then that's gonna pop up. So here, right? You think that that's a wonderful idea until we have to do mail merge. You ever had to do a mail merge where you've got something in there? And then you've got to go through and clean up everything because you've got, you know,
then you'd have to check. I mean, you could put, for example, for unknown, you could put like UX as an example, something that you know would probably never be put in there. Then you'd have to check and see if you do a mail merge, if there's any way you can put criteria on there that says do all the except.
Because, I mean, the biggest thing with this is, I understand what he's saying. Yeah, it will break the program if you have it as a blank value on a required field. That being said, if it's a required field, it just means there has to be something in there.
Right.
So if you have a default value, let's say, as none or unavailable or not applicable or whatever, that can be in there, and it will satisfy that required criteria, but it'll also show you there's no information in there. So whatever that default value is, though, you'll have to have that for basic, like every single field that's not required, or that is required that you don't have the data for.
Right.
If that makes sense.
Right. Because well, and like, for example, if you didn't know the company, you could put like UN company, you know, for unknown or something
or
like that.
First none,
you could do that.
Something.
Well, the problem with doing none
right. Yeah,
is that, if you put like UN or something like that
yeah.
company, then you know it's the company field.
Right, yeah, that's true.
You know,
true.
And it and you want to be specific
yeah.
enough.
That's true.
Plus, if you have none, what if you have another field? You're going to put none in
right.
there too. Then it's going to, you know.
Yeah, that's true. But yeah, so just something like required, like just the whole required thing, you have to have a value for every single one. And I'm sure we can do a populate thing with this kind of deal, where if this isn't filled, you can autofill it with this default value or whatever it is.
Oh yeah,
but
you can set it up so that there is a default value in there, so she'd actually have to change it.
Right.
But then you could set default values literally up for everything,
yeah.
if you wanted to, you know. But I don't know, some, you know, you could also look at it that would make it maybe harder, not for her, but maybe for somebody else who might end up doing some work to actually understand what's going on.
Well, I mean,
so.
What you could do is, can't you put in a, you can put this in a text box where, like, for example, say, like, John or whatever as, like, first name. Kind of like, almost like an example thing there, like, as, like, a background text. If you click it automatically clears it.
You can, yes, because you're using HTML to do
right.
that, and you can put in placeholder text.
Right.
Yes.
Would you be able to use placeholder text and put that in, and then have that, if there's nothing filled in, have it take
that's
that
a good question. I've never done that because now you're talking about programming HTML. But is
right.
there? I'm sure there probably is a way to do it. I just have never.
Yeah.
I've never been asked that question before.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Because I mean, if it's, for example, if something is left null right now, and it's
yeah.
supposed to be required, it'll just
yeah.
pull up a thing saying, "Hey, it's required."
Yes.
But if you don't have that information, then they're not going to know what to put in.
Yeah.
Especially if it's not you. Work.
Yeah, and that's where we learn, like in the item inserting, that's
yeah.
what you'd be doing. You, but yeah, that's one way you can do it. And the other way you can do it too is, you know, that there's nothing wrong with that, except it's sort of going against the grain of the way you're supposed to do it.
Yeah.
And the way you're supposed to do it is, for every field that's required, you should have a required field validator in there.
Yeah.
At a minimum. And then if it's a number field, it should be a compare validator type of thing. That, all that should be in there.
Right. And if that's the case,
But the problem is when you're working with a customer who, you know, not through any fault of their own, but doesn't have all of the information, that's not going to work then. And I don't know, even with a required field validator, I'd have to look. I don't know if a required field validator has a default that you can put in.
I don't know.
That if it fails, or if it fails, that you just throw a value in there.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I almost think that wouldn't be a validator then. I almost think that would just be like if this is there else, we're almost ever there.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, because you can check for null, that's no problem, but... if it's required and you can't, you don't have a value for that, then I guarantee you, someone else that in your company, they'll look at it and be like, well, I don't know what to do. I mean, what am I supposed to do with a required field when I don't have anything there?
Well, that's my field.
So, and that's something that we would need to address in terms of putting in a dummy value or having that. I'm sure you, like, I know you can put like a thing where it's like a placeholder, or if you click on it, whatever. Having said, can you put in code saying like, if this does this or whatever, then is that something you can do with this kind of thing? Or like if it's null in this field, whenever when it's
that
submitted,
would be easier than using a validator.
I just think that would be easier.
Yes.
Because you could just do if.
The other thing too is you have to check because people get smart, either that or get lucky or whatever.
Yeah.
But you have to check and see, for example, if there's a trim function, because people will figure out. I don't mean you. But other people can figure out, oh, got to put something in there, I'll hit the space bar.
Oh, yeah.
That used to be the biggest problem years ago in HTML forms.
Yeah.
All fields were required, but no one actually checked to see what was in there.
Yeah.
So people would hit the space bar just once, and everything would go through, and fields would be empty.
Yeah.
All right. Then they came up with the trim function, which said to remove all leading and all trailing blanks. So if you had, like, O'Fallon, and if you had O and somebody put a space between the O and the fell, it wouldn't remove that. That wouldn't fail. But if you had spaces before it or spaces at the end,
you can still do that.
Yeah. And I mean, you can write your own if there isn't
easy.
One that's related. Yeah, you can write it in two lines. That's not a big thing.
I just think that would be the best way to do it because I don't think, I mean, as much as a validator would be helpful, I don't see how it would help an end user because. I mean, there's obviously like going to be some way to like.
No, where it would help, where it would actually help would be on when you're inserting a new record.
Yeah.
That would help.
Yeah. I guess it's kind of a toss-up, really. Is there a way to make it so that, I'm sure there's a way, but I don't know how easy it would be, to where it shows you once, and if you just hit submit again, it would automatically go through.
Yeah, there is a way to do that. Yeah, you'd have to literally do check in your submit, and if they click submit and they did absolutely nothing else and they click submit again, then you'd have to go in and fill it in with yes, you can do things. I know what you're talking about. I've done it not in ESP.NET, but I've done it in HTML and JavaScript and CSS. So yes, there are ways that it can be done.
I mean, that's an option, I think, but I don't
but,
think they...
But even doing that, then what you do is you come up and you say, you have left off values for these fields. Okay, you give them a message. You say, if you want default values to be put in again, just click submit again.
Right.
And you put it on them. You know, and I don't think that's a big thing. I wouldn't think that would be a big thing.
Either that or you could just, I mean, you could have a pop-up come up and say these values.
Well, that's pretty much what it is,
yeah. Just have, like, do you want this to happen, yes or no? And no, it'll pull up what you have still, and yes, it'll submit it for sure and put in dummy values. So that's an option, too. I don't think that would be easier.
So do we need to watch all the tables now?
Well, don't you need to know what fields are going to be
required,
and which ones can be left null?
Yeah.
Well, and that's where...
There's a lot that what?
Can be left null.
Yeah. And I'm looking at the, and I mean, other than the first name and the last name.
I understand. Or if, like she said, if she just gets someone's card, there's going to be probably a lot more left off than there will be on there. All right. What would be kind of neat, and again, this would be not something more necessarily that they do, but what would be nice would be if every time you get a new contact, we could create some kind of a form or something that would send them an email and say, hey, we would love to put you into our database. Could you please fill this out? And you'd have everything in there you'd need.
Actually, it's funny that you mentioned that, because that's actually what we're talking about. So, but I want to make sure that Ethan gets his opportunity, and I think we need to talk about this, because I'm looking at this, and I'm trying to figure out, we've got 13 tables, so you're working with who? Who's your team? Huh? Okay, so... Do you have this that we can put
it up? I got it up there.
Oh, fantastic. All right, so I've got questions.
Yes.
Yes, I have questions, or yes, the answer is yes. All right, help me out. So the first thing, I showed this to my boss, and he said, wow, you guys have done such a great job. So much work has already been put into this. So he recognizes that. So that's the entire group. You just happen to be given that particular one.
Yeah.
I finally figured out primary key, and then this is the FK is
foreign key.
Foreign
key. What you do with a foreign key is typically you take a primary key. When you got a relationship that's one to many, and
okay.
If you don't know what that is, it's like, for example, every one company could have many products. That
mm-hmm.
type of thing.
Okay.
So if sometimes in order to be able to combine those two tables together in what's called a join, you take the primary key from the one side
mm-hmm.
and you put it in as a field in the many side as a foreign key, so
yeah.
you are able to join them together.
Okay.
And he, you know, one of the things that Ethan mentioned to me too with all this was, yeah, sometimes it might look like, yeah, there's a duplicate, yeah, we've got this field, but it, from what you had been able to ascertain based on conversations with you, this is the kind of setup that you would need in order to be able to give you the information that you needed to get.
Okay, so with that in mind, and figuring that that was pretty close to what was being done here.
No, I can make these bigger too. I mean, if you want to move up and
no,
up and down them, etc.
No, because I want to have it all in one space so that
right.
we can write. So that needs to be, if we make it one step smaller. Yeah. Okay, so that should be all of it, right? So what, please, if I'm wrong, help me out here. I feel as though, based on this scheme, that you're using the contact person as your jumping point. Is that correct? And then it... jumping point would just be that this was the easiest one to put together and everything kind of went off of this. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to make sure I understand. That's the only question I'm having.
Yeah.
So under the primary key for the contact person, that's just a random number that's assigned. I'm asking questions.
An increment.
Okay. So we've got the salutation, the first name, middle name, all the things that we've talked about, as well as the person's notes.
Yeah.
Then you have a foreign key, which is the company ID that goes down to here. You have a foreign key, which is the employee ID, because we're putting our information
that's
in.
For an employee, that's what that means.
Okay.
What is an employee user manufacturer? Yeah, I just have a thing just in case we decide to do that functionality.
Okay. Well, we are going to do that functionality.
All right, cool.
So, and then like I said, some of this may be you guys are doing this or the other part of the Michael's doing it. Either way, that is a function. Contact info. So is this contact info foreign key? I guess I'm explain this relationship to me. Can you? So if you have contact person and then contact info, so this is just all of the.
That's specific. That's literally what it is. Contact information.
I see.
The contact person table is. I have that organized in a way where it's just things that a person has. You know, it's like a first name. Very specific to the person.
Okay.
Kind of referring to a contact is a different entity. You can have a contact between, you can have a company contact and not necessarily a person.
Got it.
And I've seen seen that in the data, where there's not a name, you know, so.
Okay.
That's why that's split up.
No, yeah, you're good. I just wanna make sure I understand. And then, so then that makes sense as to why we have contact info then.
Yes.
So you have the primary, secondary.
Those very same things can be shared between the company and just the person themselves, 'cause I looked through the data and you have people with their home addresses.
Right.
And not the company, you know, and stuff like that, so.
But if there's a company ID, then it goes.
Evan wanted that. Can you explain that, Evan?
The reason why I wanted that is because previously the only connection between the person and the company was the contact info. If you had contact info for a person and that's not the exact same as the contact info for the company, there's no way to associate a person with a company.
Got it.
So putting the company ID in there for the contact.
It looks like it's loose or something, but it's not really that.
No, 'cause we had talked about that, right?
Right.
Where I need to know that this, you know, that if you're putting in Google into this, that it's not associated with the contact, that it's associated with the company, so that you could then go to all these other things, and that's, I'm assuming.
Those other things are more related to a company rather than a person, you know, 'cause financing.
Right.
Well, I say you have to have a company to get those kind of loans in the first place, so that's why I put it in your company, and then the tenant, you got, you know, you're a company that's, you know, that you gotta release an applicant. Relationship phases, same way, you know, that's.
Okay. So then we've got, so I'm gonna stick on this side, so let's finish up with the contact then. So then under contacts, I feel, and so this is where I get confused, and my confusion is basically just because I don't necessarily understand how you're breaking things out. I do understand the EDC part of it, because we are the users of this database, and we have different functionalities that we have to have. Username, password, we're entering the information. Did that get put in here somewhere? Oh, I guess that's just a function of the entry, right? This is the tables, not the actual function. No, maybe it was.
Yeah, the employee will be associated with the person's putting.
So, then you put in, for the board of directors, it's its own table.
Yeah.
Right? So if this person and a radio button gets pushed, that they end up on the board of directors, and then they get their own primary key. And I guess I don't understand that. Why are they getting their primary key? What happens when they get taken out of the board of directors? It's not a permanent position.
So, for all the tables, the EDC, the events, whatever, where it has that foreign key going back to the person, the primary key is nothing. It's just saying that it's its own unique record.
Right.
And then the
okay.
person ID is getting put in there that associates the person with those people.
It's a link to the person.
So
it's not getting its own.
Okay.
Yeah. It's not like getting some news.
Every table has a primary key that has ID. They're not necessarily, I mean, there are some associations between some of them, their foreign keys and other tables,
yeah.
But there, that is, ideally, that is to be an unintelligible field. So if you might know that 287 is Google, but that doesn't mean anything, and if anybody finds it out, it doesn't matter.
Right.
That kind of an idea. But as far as what you said, that's just going to be a number that's associated with someone. And if they leave, their record can go away.
Okay.
Yeah.
But and that's fine. Actually, what we probably need to add to this is former.
Yeah, IDAB and that DOB is fine. It wasn't fine at one time.
Okay, so yeah, and we're gonna talk about that, because I just want to make sure that we're where we need to be.
Yeah.
So then under the board of directors, this contact person, the person ID, then we'll identify them as the board of director, either on the executive board, loan committee, the audit, and finance, and the IDA. Okay. The only other part of this is, and I don't know if this goes into this table or somewhere else, but if they were a board member.
If they are a board member, we're at one point.
Right. And then the only other part of this, and I don't see anything in this term. That's all I care about. Right. What we're going off of is we don't have a functional database right now, and we keep getting asked questions that we cannot pull out of current data. And one of those things that the president of our organization is he's got it somewhere in his head when the term expires, but it's hard for everybody else to know when the term expires, right?
Is that what term means?
Yeah.
Start and end.
Term.
You know, you want term expiration date or something, or what? What?
Start and expire.
Okay.
Let's just say that's two fields.
Yeah,
okay.
I understand that.
Okay.
Unless you know, unless it's common, where you could again make it almost not a drop down, but the equivalent where you would just have different entries. Where you could pick one, like if all of them were like 2018 to 2019, 2019 to 2020, so you could do that. You could populate. You could do it for the next 50 years, if you really wanted to do that.
I just know that what usually ends up happening, and so that's the reason why I'm looking at this, and I'm like, okay, well, if we're going to create this, and this is three more lines that you're creating in the system. Then let's create three more lines. I say that like it's just so easy. It's like an insert on that. It's an insert on an Excel spreadsheet for me. For you, it's a bunch of code. So then I understand that. This is, then yes. Fantastic.
Okay.
Right.
No,
that's the reason why I would much rather not populate and get this spot on, and then me go in and enter 2,500 records.
And that's fine, except it would be nice, even right now, for the ones you're going through, if you put an X, the ID field's going to be mandatory, the one at the top.
Right.
But if there's other fields in there that you have to have.
Right.
Even if you right now put an X in there so he knows that those cannot be null.
Right. So this, I would say that if we don't have a first name, a last name, I'd like to do an if then, but I know that's not going to be possible. And what I mean by that is, if I don't have a primary phone number, then I need to have an email. If I don't have an email, then I need to have it. But I don't see that that's going to work.
I don't know. Yeah, you might have to write that in the code that you would have to check. And if they were both. Yeah.
Then
all your records have one or the other.
Right.
Yeah, I can't.
When I started to look through, I didn't go through all 2,400 of them, but the ones I saw.
Okay.
Required enough. Yeah, I know it's dictate what it wants.
Right.
Okay.
Not if this one is, that sort of thing.
There has to be.
Right.
There has to be something. So I would almost say, and so this is where when we were talking about what needs to be void, how you can get around something, I would almost say First name, last name is a must. Primary address, city, state, and zip is a must. Primary phone number is a must. And then what I will do in my procedures is say, if you don't have a phone number, enter zeros. Then that way I know that that's been looked at. Because you can't require a company. We have a lot of retired people that, you know what I'm saying? So that would have, I mean, I would really go with, we have to have.
Now, I think a lot of records have the address and the
date. I don't know. I have to.
Probably not. Well, then we can't look at it. So we'll have to find the place to replace it.
There's, that's the problem. There's nothing in there that's 100%. The data is bad.
Well, it's going to break the database if you make it null, and then that your information that I'm pulling in there doesn't have that. We cannot make that null.
Can we? Okay, so then let's do that. Can we import data in blocks?
What data? Like, are you looking like import contacts? Or are you looking like, if you're trying to just import addresses for
I honestly believe that this is going to be that no data can be imported. I can't see that this is going to happen. I don't want to break the database, and I want to make sure everything in there is clean. And the only way that I can make sure that it's clean is by entering it.
But that's why, like you said, if nothing else, if you went in and put in all the people that you work with, you know,
right,
as an example, and even if you dummied up some of their stuff as far as company ID or whatever,
right,
so they wouldn't all be, you know, SEC, EDC, but if you had something where you could put them in, that would give them something to work with. And then,
right,
I, like I said, I think once you saw everything in there, then you'd be able probably to have a better idea of, yeah, we need this, or no, we don't need this. But some of it right now is just speculating.
Well, and that's my problem. So, because I know my data. I know my data. And that's why I'm saying I think that all we can require are those. But even then, our data currently doesn't have all that information.
And that's where you might have to take time out of your life to put in 2,500 records or hire somebody or do.
Exactly, and I'd rather have clean data than that.
Yeah. Well, and it's the same thing Brady and I were talking before. We could put in dummy data. That's not doing you any good.
Not doing me any good.
Because eventually you need good data.
So that's why I wonder. And then if it's in an Excel spreadsheet, right? That I give that to you. I don't know. You'll have to give me. You'll have to tell me what your format is. If I took every single one of these and made it a title, right, the header for in an Excel spreadsheet, and then I put in the 15 people that work at the EDC, and I filled that in,
yes,
with everything,
you know,
with the yeses and the noes, I'm assuming, I don't know what that would look like.
The only ones technically you'd have to fill in, the only fields, would be ones that are required.
Right.
And we can set it up so that the rest would automatically, so there'd be nothing in them.
Right.
So, I mean, if you decided for, let's say, as an example, I know this isn't the case, but let's say you had no emails. Let's just say you had none.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you're not going to be able to check for something at something because it's not in there.
Right.
You know, but they can be filled up where they just put in certain things. That's not a problem. But and those certain things would have to be your required fields.
Okay. So company name. No.
So everything you're dotting right there, you're considering.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm just trying to be sure.
These are the only things that I would say
going forward would be required.
Okay, and I mean, even if you want to do the ones that are up above too.
They're at these, so all of these.
Right, but I mean, I'm talking about all 13 tables, because that way when he creates this, and I'll generate those files for him, and then he'll generate the schema from those files.
That can't be. I'll get it. This.
Was it all required?
No. I can't require any of that.
I really, and I understand that they, that's why I didn't search for it.
Okay.
I get that, you know, and you don't have time to do it.
Can't even have industry files. The most that I can have is contact information.
Right, but I want to make sure you know too, like for example with the industry. That table doesn't necessarily say that you need that for every contact. What that is those are all the industries you deal with. You see what I'm saying?
Well, but the industry type, I think you already have the drop down Excel spreadsheet that I had given you that I was working with. I think we have to figure that out a little bit better. Because it's
set up more set up to where you have to make it separate to run the understanding of the
Because actually, you know, if you don't have the right NAICS code, then there's no reason to put in an industry thing. I'm just drawing now. But you see what I'm saying? I think you and I are speaking. But if I don't have a name, if I don't have a name and I don't have at least an address, then there's no reason why that person should be in my database.
I don't know how it is to you guys there.
So the IBA is a committee.
It is a committee.
Yeah, let's just go ahead and call it an IBA.
Well, then I'm going to rename it.
Rename it to the IDA committee.
But
and the thing is,
did I have, so
I'm not worried about that. She can search for the board of directors.
And I ask the same question, this is what I get. And I'm like, does it belong in the board of directors?
Yeah.
The individuals in the IDA are members of the board of directors, but you still have to make the distinction. So I would call the
committee.
Here's where this doesn't make sense to me. All right. So if you remember the last time that we had talked about, and I had it over here, which was impact. Right? How had we dealt with that individual or that company? And it was part of this, and it's under resources provided. This actually relates
that entire table.
So I wouldn't even use financing.
Okay.
504, SBDC.
Well,